A new coalition is to be decided in Ireland after its snap general election. Fianna Fail won the most seats, but opposition party Sinn Féin did make some gains. So, what's next for Ireland? Hello and welcome to Roundtable. I'm Enda Brady. Now, it could be months before Ireland forms its new government. Fianna Fail and Fine Gael will go into coalition together again, but are two seats short, so they'll need help from Ireland's smaller parties. Micheál Martin, leader of Fianna Fail, is likely to be the next Taoiseach.
The good news came early on for Micheál Martin. One of the first to secure a seat in the new Irish Parliament, it set the stage for what would come next. His centre-right party, Fianna Fail, now poised to become the largest. But he won't be able to govern alone.
This is not easy, there will be a lot, you know, whatever group of parties engage in discussions or in negotiations, it will mean very detailed work will have to be done in terms of a programme for government.
In Ireland, coalitions are pretty much the norm, meaning he'll likely team up again with the party of current Prime Minister or Taoiseach Simon Harris. The pair have been governing together since 2020, and Fine Gael did well in this election, despite concerns a number of campaign mishaps would hurt his chances of re-election.
But what I am very confident about is that my party will have a very significant role to play in the years ahead, and I'm cautiously optimistic and excited about what the weeks ahead hold.
They'll also need support from a smaller party, and with their current coalition partner, the Greens, decimated, who will that be? Then there's the main opposition party, Sinn Féin, strongly linked to the Irish Republican movement and pro-unification with British-controlled Northern Ireland. Despite a strong performance, there wasn't the momentum it had hoped for, especially as nobody will work with them.
I do not want to see another 5 years of the kind of chaos, the kind of disregard that we have seen under Fine Gael and Fianna Fail. I think that is a bad outcome for our society.
The question going into this election was, could Sinn Féin's Mary Lou MacDonald succeed in dismantling the status quo? Was Ireland ready for a change after more than 100 years under the same political parties? While this election may have established Sinn Féin as a major political force in Ireland, voters seem to have stuck with what they know. Parliament should sit for the first time on December the 18th. So, what will happen next?
Well, let's meet our guests. Joining us from Cork is the Irish broadcaster Jonathan Healy. In Donegal, in the northwest of Ireland, we have Catherine Noone. She's a lawyer and a former Fine Gael politician. And in Belfast, we have John Tonge. He is Professor of Politics at the University of Liverpool. You're all very welcome to Roundtable. Jonathan Healy in Cork, I'll come to you first. You got your prediction right on Roundtable. Everything stays the exact same in Ireland.
I've been telling you for years, Enda, to trust me and back me and my horse racing predictions as well. It really is as you were. The two largest political parties, Fianna Fail and Fine Gael, are two seats short of an overall majority in the 34th Dáil. Now, to explain to an international audience what that means is the centre held. We didn't have any breakthrough from either the left or the right. And instead of a traditional two-party system consisting of those parties that we've had in Ireland for a century, we can now for sure say that we have a three-party system with a series of others vying for control. So the question now that the dust has settled is, who will actually be in that government along with Fianna Fail and Fine Gael? Why are we excluding Sinn Féin from those conversations? Well, both of those other parties have said that Mary Lou MacDonald's party does not align with their objectives for government, so they are out. So, as I said, the centre held, and Ireland bucks a trend right across the continent of Europe where voters have given outgoing governments a bit of a kicking.
Catherine, give us your assessment of Fine Gael's performance. It's your party. Going into the election, Simon Harris as Taoiseach, there was a good bounce in his favour. And then it seemed to kind of drop 4 or 5 percentage points and not as strong a performance perhaps as you would have liked.
No, and I think it wasn't a great campaign for Simon. I think he was unlucky with a few things that happened. I think the media, no offence to all you media guys, I think they were actually quite hard on him during this campaign. And it's not the kind of comment that I would normally make, but I feel that there was a huge focus on, with one of the papers in particular, on any little thing, you know, and it was... I know that's the way of campaigns and, you know, you're in a bubble in a campaign and it's all very heightened. But I felt he was somewhat maybe targeted, but I still think that it was a reasonably good result because there were 18 incumbents, 18 of my former colleagues who didn't run. So the incumbency factor is huge. And actually, I don't really comment on Twitter now. I hardly even go on there. But I had been on Twitter just seeing what was going on. And somebody was saying about Fine Gael's likely performance. And the one comment I made was that the incumbency factor was likely to be very big for Fine Gael. And I think it was. And I think with that in mind, it was a reasonably good performance.
And Catherine, can I just ask, there was one incident in Kanturk in County Cork where the Taoiseach, Simon Harris, had an interaction with a woman who challenged him about care and care provision and the government's record on that. He didn't handle it very well, did he?
No, I think he was dismissive at the very least. And I mean, I suppose I may be thinking of this from the human side of being a politician, but if the premise of a conversation with somebody is to tell them that they're not a good person, you know, and that's what happened in that instance. You know, do we have to hang around and have a conversation with somebody who says you're not a good person without knowing you? You know, that's just one take I have on it. But I don't think he handled it well. And I think it was very intensified in the media. I'd be interested in what the others think of that. But, you know, I mean, it wasn't handled well and it didn't help.
John, to you, I want to talk about Mary Lou MacDonald and Sinn Féin. Do you think she will be right to feel aggrieved at being squeezed out of coalition talks? And, you know, a good, strong performance again from Sinn Féin, but absolutely no prospect of getting into government.
Sinn Féin can't complain about being squeezed out of government because, let's face it, they lost almost 117,000 first preference votes. Their vote was 5.5% down. So there was absolutely zero prospect of Sinn Féin getting into government. Now, if you look at the percentage seats within the Dáil, Sinn Féin's percentage is almost unchanged. It's down by slightly less than 1%. So Sinn Féin has become less transfer toxic. Sinn Féin's candidate placements were actually quite effective this time round. So it wasn't a catastrophic election for Sinn Féin, but they're still nowhere near a government. Now, in many ways, Sinn Féin has achieved something in Irish politics because they have consolidated the realignment of Irish politics. What was civil war politics between Fianna Fail and Fine Gael is over. They are now seen as part of the same bloc, you know, as they were in 2020, but now consolidated in 2024. And what you've got is the centre or centre-right versus Sinn Féin at the head of a left axis. The question beg now is, of those parties on the left axis, will any jump into bed with Fianna Fail and Fine Gael on this new bloc? If I was the leader of either the Social Democrats or the Labour Party, I'd be very, very wary of doing that, given what happened to the Greens at this election as the junior coalition partner, going down from 12 seats to a single seat. You know, why would you want to jump into bed when, frankly, you're always cannibalised by the larger parties in a coalition? So Sinn Féin, in that sense, you know, it's as you were. They are the undisputed leaders of the opposition. But Sinn Féin a year ago, when they were riding very high in the polls, were very hopeful of a lot more. The prospect of Mary Lou MacDonald ever becoming Taoiseach seems as distant today as it ever was.
Jonathan, would you go along with that she's now out in the wilderness, leader of the opposition for the next few years?
Yeah, certainly. If a stable government can be put together and with 86 seats out of a possible 88 for a majority, it would appear that they don't need a huge amount of support from another party to keep them in government, just perhaps enough independence that they will get votes passed. But one of the former Taoiseach prime minister had said that you need a cushion. You need at least 8 seats so that you can lose a few of your own along the way, as he said. I mean, mean, John is absolutely right. There is something I refer to in Irish politics as small party syndrome. The smallest party in a coalition ends up as the moral mudguard for all the failings of that party, that government. And the Greens in this circumstance epitomise that. They lost all of their sitting TDs, that's MPs, in the last Dáil. They only returned one, Roderick O'Gorman, who was the leader of the party going into this election, and he now stands as their only representative in Dáil Éireann. The entire electorate seemed to blame them for many of the ills of the outgoing government, and really there will be no appetite from those smaller parties to rush in, knowing that their fate could very well be sealed by such a decision. The other thing that's worth noting, Enda, is that left, the Labour Party and the Social Democrats, they're kind of the same thing. I know they won't like me saying that, but they effectively are parties on the centre-left. Their policies are relatively similar. The Social Democrats a lot newer. There had been a lot of discussion about them joining forces in recent years. Had they done so, they may very well have 22 seats in the Dáil, which would make them a sizeable party within their own right. But now it looks like the mood music might be for them to sit this one out, to make sufficient noise on the opposition position benches, so that perhaps the electorate can be faced with a potential real left alternative when it comes to the next election, which constitutionally has to be held within 5 years.
Catherine, the Green Party virtually wiped out then across Ireland. What does that say about their policies or their people? What was it that the electorate didn't like?
I think, you know, and I'd love to say it was just rural Ireland who went against them. But, you know, Dublin Bay South didn't return. You know, none of the Dublin constituencies, bar Dublin West, which, by the way, is a five-seater, and he got the last seat. And no disrespect to anyone, it's a perfectly legitimate seat, but it shows you the level of popularity for a guy who was on the doors since he was much younger, working very hard in that area, and would be very well got. So, you know, you'd expect that the Greens would have a certain following in Dublin. That hasn't transpired. I think that there was a very consistent negative interpretation of any of the Green Party's motivations on social media, which I don't think has helped them. And, you know, I think at times their former leader came out with some suggestions that really kind of really irritated rural people.
John, to you, do you think other European Green parties should be looking at what's happened in Ireland and looking ahead to the year ahead with trepidation?
Yes, I think they should, because the Greens, support for the Greens tends to blow hot and cold. It tends to vary considerably. They don't have the brand loyalty that other political parties enjoy. And if you look at Fianna Fail and Fine Gael, and I know this might sound paradoxical, given that both of those parties have suffered collapses in support at various times this century, but they do have a certain brand loyalty that the Greens don't have. There were other particular issues for the Greens. Catherine's already touched upon some rural voters felt that they were completely unrealistic. Others pointed out that some Green Party TDs had quite a penchant for, you know, international air travel, which seemed at odds with the Green agenda. And also the problem, if you're a small party like the Greens, is that the big parties will pick off the best of your policies and you're left, you know, defending the rest. It's easy to use them as whipping boys and whipping girls if you're that small party. There's a brand loyalty to Fianna Fail and Fine Gael, as I say. Plus the fact is that, you know, the Greens and other parties of the left would have done better had the Irish economy been ailing. But it wasn't. One of the most important statistics from the election was that 65% of electors said that their household finances had either stayed the same or got better over the last year. And the bulk of that 65% were voting for either Fianna Fail or Fine Gael. That's why you've had the unusual situation, as Jonathan outlined at the start, of incumbents being returned, because the Irish economy is performing arguably the best of any Western European economy at the moment. You can try and pick holes in that and say, look, the tax receipts are very, very dependent upon a small number of American multinationals. But the fact is the economy is doing well, and that's why people were prepared to return a government rather than take a gamble on backing parties of the left.
Jonathan, the coalition coming back in then, are we likely to see a rotating Taoiseach, a rotating premiership every 6-12 months? What's going to happen?
Well, this was a lot cleaner and the last time around, because both parties were relatively similar in the number of seats that they held in the Irish Parliament. However, this time, Fianna Fail, which is the party led by Micheál Martin, hold 10 seats more there on 48 to Fine Gael's 38. So, of course, there is a suggestion now that perhaps Fianna Fail might try and say, well, we're the biggest party and we will lead the coalition. Fine Gael are talking about parity of esteem. That's a phrase that's been used quite a lot since polling day, meaning that they want the same kind of arrangement that would have been in place before, where the Fianna Fail leader was prime minister for 2.5 years, the Fine Gael leader was prime minister for 2.5 years. I think that once they get into those talks and start having meaningful negotiations in the new year, there will probably be a realisation that that's not going to be the same this time around. Perhaps Fianna Fail may hold on to the premiership for slightly longer, a pro rata Taoiseach, if we could call it that. But I think these are arguments that will not necessarily hold up government from being formed. There is an imperative. John touched on it there. The Irish political system is painfully aware of the change that is coming in the United States with another Donald Trump presidency. A lot of the financial success that has come through Ireland has been through American multinationals, and we could see a situation where those companies come under pressure to relocate or repatriate some of their assets to the United States. That could have an impact on the Irish economy. So stability is the key word that both parties are going to use. Yes, there will be fake wars and constant discussions and briefings behind people's backs, but to get back into government buildings is the priority for both, to ensure that there is stability.
Catherine, is that a worry then, as we look towards Trump's new presidency, that he's all about America first and a huge number of American corporations are based in Ireland?
Yeah, I mean, that's the economic reality in Ireland. And I think Jonathan has articulated the situation very well there. That's going to be at the forefront of the thinking of both parties. I mean, they're used to working together as well, and a certain level of professionalism and respect has been garnered over the last number of years. And I think Fine Gael will be less likely to go into government unless there is parity of esteem. And, you know, they would have to weigh up if they would become this smaller party, like the smaller party syndrome Jonathan spoke about. So I think if Fianna Fail are serious about wanting to get Fine Gael into government with them, which I think they are, they're going to want parity of esteem, and they're going to want Fine Gael to come on board. They have to have Fine Gael on board. So it puts them in a slightly weaker negotiation position, even though they are 10 seats ahead, in the sense that, you know, they really want Fine Gael, or where do they go? To a mismatch of all sorts of people on the left whose policies wouldn't be in keeping with Fianna Fail's policies. So I think you have to measure the fact that Fianna Fail people might think they deserve a longer Taoiseach, or just having the Taoiseach's role, a Fianna Fail role. But you have to measure that with the fact that Fine Gael are their main choice to coalesce with.
John, I want to talk about the far right. There was a huge amount of chatter on social media, an awful lot of empty vessels making a lot of noise, and they didn't return a single candidate anywhere across the whole of Ireland. Talk to me about that.
Yeah, the far right, the threat from the far right was talked up excessively. In one sense, it was understandable, because this time last year, November 2023, there was a very, very serious riot in Dublin, and it looked as if immigration issues could turn very, very ugly indeed. There were a large number of independent candidates, by no means all fixated with immigration, but there was a significant number. There were some far-right parties standing. They got nowhere. Why did they get nowhere? Well, if you look, only 6% of the Irish electorate said that immigration was the top issue. People were much more interested, in the end, in the economy, in the state of housing, education, etc. Immigration wasn't a top issue. The fact is as well that immigration, there's not much you can do to control it, in a sense, by virtue of European Union membership. People came to recognise that. Now, it's worth remembering, turnout fell at this election. Fewer than 6 in 10 electors actually went to the polls. And there is a suggestion, at least, that some of those stayaways were people so disenchanted with the system that, you know, including people who feel very strongly on immigration, they wouldn't go and vote even for those anti-immigrant independents who were standing, or small far-right parties who were standing. But it was the dog that didn't bark in many ways, immigration, at this election. I think Sinn Féin were the party that potentially, you know, stood to lose out most by that, because they couldn't go careering off to the right to try and deal with the immigration issue. They refused to do that. And yet there was a section of their working class base that was very, very vocal, denouncing Sinn Féin as traitors. And I think that partly contributed to Sinn Féin's fall in the opinion polls. There were other reasons as well. So immigration it had some impact upon the election, certainly in terms of Sinn Féin support, I think, but nowhere near the impact upon the support bases of other political parties.
Jonathan, how worried should we be about the turnout? Because only 50% of the electorate actually bothered voting.
Yeah, it was the lowest turnout in the history of Irish elections, which, given we had a very, I won't call it a boring campaign, but a fairly straightforward campaign, wasn't that surprising. The electorate just wasn't as engaged as it would be if there perhaps was a national crisis that had engulfed us. I'm old enough to remember the 2011 election when Fianna Fail was led by Micheál Martin for the first time into government, into opposition as it was at the time. They were leaving government, and that was a very high turnout because the stakes were unbelievably high. There was a sense this time that the stakes weren't as high. Those on the left are saying that they feel a lot of their supporters didn't vote because they knew there was no point in voting for Sinn Féin if both Fianna Fail and Fine Gael said they weren't going into government with them. So there is a little bit of disenfranchisement there, if I can use that word, that these people felt that it wasn't worth their while turning out. That said, the Irish system is unbelievably representative. So even of the 59% that turned out, we did get exactly what that 59% wanted, which is a very fractured Dáil Éireann, with parties from across the far left, to the left, to the centre, to the centre right. None, as you've pointed out, on the right of the equation. But that really sums up where Ireland is in 2024. And really, the call was for stability, and stability the voters got.
And Catherine, Ireland will continue to play its part on the European stage, proud member of the European Union, whoever is Taoiseach for the next few years and however it rotates.
Absolutely. I mean, Europe has been very positive for Ireland. There's a huge satisfaction rating with Europe in all opinion polls. And going back to opinion polls and actually the turnout, if you don't mind for a second, because I have an interesting point to make. Well, what I think is an interesting point on this. I was listening to an expert in this area this morning, and because all of the register of electors in Ireland is controlled by all of the individual councils around the country. There are a lot of people on the register in certain areas who no longer live at certain addresses. And they reckon that the actual turnout is underestimated by about 10% because of that. I hadn't heard that said before, but I thought that was really interesting. But yes, Europe... Irish people are, you know, in the main, over 80% satisfied with Europe. We will always, be very grateful for that and very sorry that our nearest neighbours decided to exit Europe, because it had the effect of, you know, they shot themselves in our foot in a way. But, we're Europhiles, happy Europeans in Ireland for the most part.
Jonathan, final point to you. Just talk us through what happens now. How quickly will this coalition deal be sealed?
Well, take a comfortable seat, because it's going to take time. We look back to formations of governments in the past. It has always come down to horse trading for as long as I've been covering politics here. We are starting at a slightly better point insofar as we have two parties that were in government together that have worked well together for the last four and three quarter years. But it is the third leg of the stool that we need to put in place. And when you are negotiating with independents, the question is, do you bring them in to be part of the government, invite some of them perhaps to represent their constituencies at a cabinet level or a junior ministerial level, or do you just bring them on board in some kind of confidence and supply arrangement. In the past in Ireland, this has worked out very well for independent candidates who will say, well, I'm delivering for my part of the world because I'm supporting the government, and they'll cut the ribbon on occasional new roads or hospital wings. So it will take time. It will be January at least before we see any form of serious horse trading going on. But remember, we have that external imperative, which is potential disruption to trade from Donald Trump's presidency. How quickly that happens, we don't know. But what all of those who are negotiating this formation are going to be conscious of is it will be better to have that government in place as quickly as possible. But again, it's Ireland. We don't move quickly when it comes to these things. And we do have a stable transition of power, that the old cabinet remain in place until the new cabinet is appointed. So there is a transition caretaker role. But as for the final makeup of the next government, take a comfy seat.
We have one here, Jonathan, at the round table. Jonathan, Catherine and John, Gorathmila Mahagiv, thank you all so much. Remember, you can see more discussion and debate on our YouTube channel. Just search for Roundtable TRT World. But for now, from me, Enda Brady, and all of the team here, goodbye and thank you for watching.